To hear the great insight coming from the epitome of greatness himself. His name stands tall in the Indian political and administrative domain. From holding various cabinet portfolios to undertaking various reforms, he has been instrumental in myriads of organizational transformation. India's Sherpa to G7 and G20, he is well known for his flair and out-of-the-box thinking. He is a glorious personality of impeccable integrity, admired for his passion and commitment towards society at large. He is well known as a man of action, having a penchant for undertaking reforms, scripting turnarounds, and achieving superlative success by working in mission mode. It is an honor for us to host you, sir. May I now invite Honorable Director, sir, to address us and deliver a welcome note to the guest of honor, Sri Suresh Prabhu, sir.
Sure. Kanchan, let me welcome the Honorable Member of Parliament, Rajya Sabha, Sri Suresh Prabhuji. Sir, I had the privilege of being a part of the seminar about one and a half month ago when you spoke about the Indian economy and Atmanirbhar Bharat, sir. It was a very informative session, and today we have the privilege of hosting you in IIM Vishakhapatnam itself, sir. This student, I must congratulate the student cohort for inviting you. This is a very vibrant cohort of students, sir. They are great achievers, top performers. They keep winning prizes and accolades in all events across the country. And as you can see, their spirit is not dampened by the COVID situation. And today, we have you, sir, here addressing the gathering, and it will be a great learning for all of us. Our friends, just to make a few very two, three introductory remarks, drawing from what Sri Suresh Prabhuji had addressed last time and the key takeaways from it. He spoke about the importance of bottom-up planning in the country, bottom-up development in the country, because that is the one that would actually take us from $2.5 trillion economy thereabouts to about $5 trillion economy that we are aspiring for. And, if you start a bottom-up development, how it can leverage the human capital and the natural resources better. He spoke about the importance of the country being a knowledge economy. Knowledge economy, all of us know that we have, is the, for the first time ever that we have broken into the top ranks of being the top among the 50 top countries as per the Global Innovation Index. So Prabhuji spoke about the importance of intellectual property, patents, copyrights, trademarks, geographical indicators, for example, which protect the good work and skill of our artisans, etc. So, and another point that he highlighted is we might start small as MSMEs, but the important part about it is we need to integrate with the global supply chains so that we are able to build capacities inside the country and to become a really self-reliant, self-sufficient, and kind of self-generating Bharat or Atmanirbhar Bharat. And Suresh Prabhuji has always highlighted, if I have to put across the many speeches that I had the privilege of listening to, he speaks about the importance of structural reforms, systemic improvements, simplification of procedures, skills upgrade, social justice in whatever we need to do, and speed and scale of implementation. As a trustee of public good, obviously, the social justice, social equity, and development for all are his mantras. I'll stop here because there is a pressure of time, on his availability here in this seminar. And I would request Suresh Prabhuji to address this gathering. Thank you very much, sir.
Thanks a lot, my dear friend, for giving me this opportunity to talk to some of the brightest of Indians and some of the brightest of teachers, faculty, who are here in IIM Vishakhapatnam. And I'm very happy and very honored by the fact that you have chosen to invite someone like me, who's not as knowledgeable as you, as accomplished as all of you, but nonetheless, the beauty of students is they like to absorb knowledge from everywhere. And that's why I'm really very happy. Also because I am a member of parliament in my sixth term from the state of Andhra Pradesh. And my home state of Andhra Pradesh is a home to, or the IIM is a home to this great state, and therefore IIM Visakhapatnam has a special place in my heart that you are going to be student from such a great institution. You are going to be the graduates of such a great alum, great management school. So therefore I must congratulate you. Thank you for inviting me. And also thank the director for giving me this opportunity to speak to you. As you know, this particular phase, and I hope it's a passing phase, in which all of us are locked down, if not physically, more so mentally. Because we feel insecure, unsafe to move around the way we are used to. We have to always wear protective masks, wash your hands all the time. I hope we don't wash our hands off the society. We have to wash our hands and we have to keep distance from each other. And I hope the distance is only physical, not emotional. And in that situation, we have to find out how do we get over this phase. And therefore I say it's a passing phase. I hope so. And it is. But it's very heartening to note that humanity has faced worse crises than this. More challenges than this, and more difficult times than this. Therefore, when I was growing up in my school, there used to be, like every good educational institution, there are always good thoughts which are displayed and portrayed on the walls to inspire people. So there was one very important thought that was mentioned there was, these two will pass. And I'm sure this will definitely pass. But the challenge is, as each one of us have, is that we want to cling to the good times and we hope they don't pass. And we want to always make sure that the bad times pass very fast. But you are business graduates, going to be graduates in business and all aspects of business. You're going to deal with management side of business from all perspectives, from materials, from human resources, from finance, from marketing, from strategic thinking, all of this. So as business leaders and business managers, you must also keep this in mind that nothing remains permanent. These two will pass. But a good business leader, knowing fully well that everything is transitory, it is also going to pass, tries to learn the best out of the best times, good times, and try to retain them as good business practices. And when there are tough times, he hopes that I will not get deterred by this, but I'm sure I will make sure that I get over this. So the good manager, that's what the MBA students should be, always be, is to get the best out of good times and remain tough during the bad times. When the going gets tough, as they say, tough gets going. So be a tough manager during tough times but also be perceptive to the good times to learn the good practices. The human history teaches us that we have survived the far worse crisis. And today's modern science, modern technologies, we're not available to those who face those tough times. Now today, we can talk about many things, but let's focus on one aspect of it, the business. What should business be doing in tough times? Anyway, come to business again. What is a business enterprise really? Is it not a manifestation of human mind? And a work of art is the same thing, manifestation of a different kind of a mind. And architecture, is it not something different? The same thing. When Usain Bolt runs so fast, you always admire him. What is he doing? He's putting his physical faculties, driven by strong mind, to use and try to accomplish something which many others cannot even think of. But is it not that many of us would have become a great sprinter. Each one of us could have been a great architect. Each one of us could have been even an artist. Not everybody, but many of us who had that ability to be doing that, but never tried that. Never went to accomplish it to its full extent. Never worked on that last mile issues. And therefore, we couldn't become the best of artists, best of architect, best of sportsperson, best of athlete. But even business, what is a business, as I said, is it not the reflection of your inner mind that comes out in open and gets manifested in business? Business is nothing but bringing the best in you in accomplishing it to outsiders as a business entity, business enterprise. So during these tough times, those businesses with a similar situation, each one of us will be facing lockdowns, each one of us will be facing disruption due to supply chain. Most of them will be facing challenges in receiving the receivables from the customers. But some of them will do far better than others. And who are they? They are the ones, as I put it, the tough. And when they're going gets tough, the tough get going, they are those going kind. So now in business, there is going to be and more opportunities. Have you noticed that when everybody is complaining about businesses being down, there are some who made money in these tough times? The owner of Amazon has become richer by several few hundred billion dollars during this time, because he realized that people may be locked down, and that's an opportunity. Because then they cannot go out. That means let me sell goods to them in their own house. I'm not saying everybody can become Amazon. I understand that. And I'm saying, and I'm not even trying to belittle the challenges of many other businesses that are faced. I fully appreciate and sympathize with them. But at the same time, I want to fire that one part of your mind, is that even in those difficult times, some people saw an opportunity. The opportunity not to exploit, but to explore the new vistas, new avenues. I am very happy that you are in a school where that kind of your mind's faculty will be fired. I am very happy to know the kind of faculty you have in your school in IIM Visakhapatnam, which will ensure that they will teach you the ABC of management. But more importantly, they'll allow you to explore that part of your mind, that part of your brain, that part of your abilities, wherein something more can happen than a normal student. See, everybody studies the several aspects of business from the same perspective. Everybody knows that business means buying material, the best of material at the lowest of price. Everybody knows that you must have a practice like what Japanese always believe in, just in time. That means you buy everything in such a way that on shop floor, material is supplied at a time when it is needed, so you don't have to maintain inventory. Maintaining inventory is a cost center. It affects your profitability. It runs into your cash flow. So, but that everybody knows, everybody agrees. But some people who come out with different ideas. So my dear friend, the world tomorrow is not the same world. We slept in pre-COVID world and woke up into the post-COVID world. And when we have woken up to a reality that don't take anything for granted. Nobody could imagine in month of January, February, or even in month of March, that situation could be as bad as what it became. And that's what is the only lesson that you can learn in life, is that don't take anything for granted. And if you're not taking anything for granted, that's the limitation of an academic education. Education can teach you something which is known till that point of time. But life begins not where the education ends, but life begins with full of uncertainties. It begins with something which is not known to human mind. How can a teacher teach you that? How can a mother teach you that? How can your parents teach you that? The people who love you the most are your parents. But even they could not teach you because they never learned it. Because they never faced it. They never experienced it. That's the beauty of life. That every moment comes with surprises. And my dear friend, therefore, the challenges of managing business in this post-COVID world is going to be always be ready to deal with the surprise. Just imagine when you are playing cricket, when you are facing Muralidharan, who is coming to each ball he plays, bowls at you, is going to be different because he's not bowling in what is called a textbook bowling manner. He's bowling in his unique style. And if every ball is different, which teacher in the world, which best of the coach in the world can teach you about how he's going to bowl? Because many times even Muralidharan himself doesn't know how he's going to bowl. And he's one of the topmost wicket taker ever in the world. So now, in the post-COVID world, the challenge of business will be how to deal with such never known facts before. And I am sure those who are born in India are actually lucky because we are trained to be trained in day-to-day life to deal with surprises at all times. I must share with you, I don't know whether, as the director was saying, he has listened to my speeches before, I don't know whether I've narrated it in instance, but I'll tell you a real story, anecdotal story. I was involved with 16 global organizations from young age. I traveled to 144 countries so far. One day, a friend of mine from Europe, from Germany actually, he came and met me and he said, I love India. A person who has lived all his life in Germany. I said, what is the reason why you love India? Because most of the Indians would love Germany and would like to spend time in Germany because everything is perfect. The answer he gave me was very interesting. He says, my problem is in Germany, everything is fully known to you. No more surprises. If train is going to come at 5:37, it will come at 5:37. It will not come at 5:38 or 5:36. In India, I always like that there are a lot of surprises. Now just imagine, in a way, you can look at German society, German economy, from that perspective, everything is well managed. In India, you can always find fault because there are surprises. But in a situation like this, which has developed during COVID, which is a better place, in India, you have to always deal with surprises. Even if you have booked a ticket for your travel, sometimes you will be surprised when you go to board train or plane or bus or whatever. You'll be told, oh, sorry, but you know, there is a last minute change. But that gives you, develops your mind to deal with any contingency in such a way that will equip you to deal with this challenging situation that have been posed by the post-COVID world. I know there is never anything perfect. But at the same time, there is always better that you train your mind to deal with any contingency, and therefore you are ready. Therefore you are never deterred by the fact that there are challenges which are coming in my way. So in today's world, the business of tomorrow, technologies are going to change. We are on the cusp of fourth industrial revolution. We are on the completely getting integrated into the digital economy. We are in the complete challenging situation where the globalization is under threat. We are entering a phase wherein multilateralism is also questioned. Despite all this, the human beings will be the same, will be facing it. They'll be at the receiving end. Who are the receiving end? These are all externalities. Who are at the receiving end is a person. And that person's ability to deal with externalities depends upon his own mind, his own strength. That is what you'll have to be in the next several years. Be a strong person with a strong mind to face any eventuality, any challenges, any contingency, and face it in a way, in a brave way, so that you emerge victorious. You will learn a lot in your school, in IIM Visakhapatnam, but what we learn when you go out of campus is more important. Actually, you're very lucky that Visakhapatnam is one of the best cities in India. I feel the best city, not the best, the best city. It is like the Riviera of France, the southern France. So beautiful. If given a chance, I would like to come and settle down for permanently. But when you go out of a campus, campus is more secure, more planned, more with less surprises when you are in campus. Just stay part of campus and you know that a street vendor, a shop owner, a public transport operator, anybody will always present you with surprises. He will not do everything that you are expecting him to do. Because you are working in a perfect situation, whereas he is operating in his own world. I think what is important is to be a good student in campus, which you must be, because that gives you, equip you with a lot of strength and knowledge. But at the same time, be a good citizen to face such challenges and uncertainties of real world outside the campus. So I'm very sure in the years to come, we'll see the best of you in terms of how do you deal with such uncertain challenges of tomorrow. And let me tell you that till Corona came in, COVID happened, everybody was thinking, no, this is, we know everything about everything. The best of the countries in the world, the biggest economies of the world suffer the most. The biggest COVID cases are in the United States, which is, happens to be the biggest economy. The top 20 economies of the world, which are called G20, have more than 80% of the cases of COVID. They account for 86% of the global GDP, but probably account for as many cases in terms of percentage. Why? I don't know. But what I know is, I think I was almost about to finish. But I'm just saying, I was mentioning about surprises, and this is another surprise that we. And therefore, let me stop here. We got disconnected. I'm really sorry about it. This was a technical problem. But let me conclude by saying that please invite me to visit your great campus soon. I'll be very happy to be there. If not as a student, which you'll definitely not admit me as a student because I'm not as intelligent and as qualified as I can see these faces there. But I'm sure you'll invite me and admit me as a visitor for a short while. And the only advantage I will derive from that is that some of these intelligent people, something will brush on me and I will benefit from that. So I will stop here. Thank you very much. Sorry, we got disconnected and I always was speaking. So my even line of thinking got disrupted. Sorry about that. But let me thank you for inviting me. In any case, I think we almost reaching the time that was stipulated for this. So thank you very much, my dear friends. Anything that you want to ask me, I'll be happy to answer for a few minutes.
Sir, we understand that you have another meeting at 3:45.
But I will wait for a few minutes to make sure that Anything you want to ask me, I can.
Yes, sir. We had a long list of questions with students.
No, you ask me. You ask me.
At least, sir, I'll just open by one general question, which kind of sums up all. Because this is a COVID time and COVID has impacted tourism, aviation, and MSME a lot. So what do you think the government should be doing or these sectors, how do you see that revival can happen in the foreseeable future?
You know, you're absolutely right. The biggest casualty of not just in India, globally, is hospitality, tourism, travel. And you can call it ICE industry, which is organizing events, organizing exhibitions, and all of that put together. It's a very, very big affected by that. Unfortunately, these are the segments of economy, which are part of service sector, which actually, incidentally, are the one of the largest employment generators. So it's a very big problem. Now, each country has responded to it in a different way. Some are giving and compensating the employers for paying salaries for those. But they are the rich economies, OECD countries. Not all countries can afford to do that. Prime Minister Modi is aware of these challenges and is trying to address them in a different way. But I think you are absolutely right in asking me this, that this is one of the most affected sector of India's economy, like it has been part of the global economy. Air travel has affected, railway travel, everything is affected. You know, India is now the third largest aviation market of the world. I was an aviation minister also. And we were hoping to be the second largest. I had organized the Global Aviation Summit, first of its kind in the world. I mean, world, huh? First time in the world. 87 countries participated in 15th and 16th of January 2019. At that time, there's no sign of COVID. And we are so bullish and so optimistic about a growth in the economy, as well as particularly the growth that will happen in this segment. So it is really badly affected. You are absolutely right. And we should do as much as possible to revive this segment for even protecting employment, also to generate more economic opportunities.
Thank you, sir. Sir, if you permit, maybe one small question. Which
no, you ask me any number. I will wait here because you are a great institution and I am your MP, so I have responsibility to answer.
Thank you very much, sir. So one question, sir, which was from the student, which was a very valid question, that by 2022, we have a target of producing more than 220 gigawatts of electricity through, cleaner sources of energy. Now, the problem which is there today is that we are only fulfilling 20% of the energy needs in India from renewable sources, less than 20%. And given this COVID, now the GDP has gone down quite a lot, and therefore the animal spirits of the industry will come back, who will want growth at one hand. At the same time, this COVID has brought this sense of sustainability again on the other hand, in the government and the policymakers. So which shall prevail in the coming future and what the government should be doing?
So it's a very good question. In fact, let me tell you that we are facing this problem of corona and COVID. Therefore, we are all very worried. Just imagine if climate change becomes the ill effect of climate change become manifested in a bigger way, what will happen to the world? Here in case of corona, we can stay home, we can wear masks, we can wash hands and we can get vaccine over a period of time and we feel we'll be secured. But what happens when the temperature goes to 2 degrees centigrade? That's the ill effect of climate change. And the agriculture will be a problem. Tourism will be affected because sea level rise. Visakhapatnam, such a beautiful city, will be under threat because of sea level rise would probably submerge the entire area. 7,600 kilometers of coastline of India would pose other challenges for the humanity. If all this happens, what is going to be the consequence of that? And mind you, why is the climate change is posing such a threat? It's a greenhouse gas emission, right? The greenhouse gas emission, the major source of it is energy and power. The fossil fuel, and more use it either as a liquid fuel or for generating electricity, this is the cause of a problem. So the only way we can address this is by changing energy mix of the world. Therefore, we have to get more and more renewable energy into a grid and also have, not in the grid, that's an old form of distributing electricity. We should actually have distributed generation. Generate locally, distribute locally. Therefore, there's no choice to do that. So therefore, what you're asking me is a valid question, that business will be under issues because of this. We have no choice but to shift to renewable energy. Energy mix has to change in a way that we can get more and more solar, wind, and other forms of renewable energy into our energy system of the world. So this is absolutely necessary. I know industry will be facing some problems, but I'll tell you something. One Indian company, you'll be surprised, and you should be proud at the same time. One Indian company from Adani Group is going to be the world's largest renewable energy company in the next few years' time. World's largest, not India's largest. This is entrepreneurship. And this is also riding on the right business model. They're doing something good for their business, but also good for society. That's what you asked me about sustainable development. The business model that we must develop should be such that we reward your shareholders. But now, of course, the new ethos are coming, which is stakeholders capitalism, not just shareholders, stakeholders capitalism. And that is what exactly the renewable energy is all about. That you make money for your own shareholders, but also reward your stakeholders by creating a better public good. I think that's why I clearly see the renewable energy business will grow in the years to come.
Sir, one last very short question. Because you talked about this supply chain and Honorable Prime Minister on many occasions talked about building a robust and vibrant supply chain and getting into the global supply chain. So now, according to you, what reforms other than infrastructure should our country take up to make it to the global supply chain or even, you know, plan to be the hub of this global supply chain?
You know, supply chains, by definition, have to be, when you talk about a chain, the chain means it has so many different components. The chain presupposes that there are so many components. So there is something starting long way down and going a far, far ahead. So India has to choose and decide which part of the supply chain we should be joining. Whether we should join in between, join in the beginning, or join at the end. Where you join is where the value addition will happen. We can join in the beginning by doing only some sort of a rudimentary work and being part of labor addition. Or you could join as much later by bringing knowledge into it, which will have intellectual property rights, which will be driving that addition, but not necessarily creating too many jobs. So it all depends where you want to join, what you want to do. But joining global supply chain is no longer a choice, but it's a necessity. It's a essential part of new businesses. The businesses will grow based on supply chains. They already emerged globally. Take example of a mobile phone. It's designed somewhere. The intellectual property right, that's a patent, is registered somewhere else. It's manufactured somewhere else. It is assembled in third place. It is marketed in different locations. So all of these are part of supply chains. So I think we'll have to be integral part of global supply chains, but not necessarily at each of the business verticals. We can be at different levels. Like, for example, it always happens. We keep climbing up the value chain. In pharmaceuticals, India has been phenomenally successful in moving from just being at some point of time reverse engineering to now becoming development of a new molecule, new drug delivery system. This happened over a period of time. So I think we'll have to learn to always constantly revisit all the supply chains and not just be wedded to it at all times, but keep being dynamic and keep doing that. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. So on behalf of the entire IIM Visakhapatnam community, I would like to thank you. We are very grateful to your kind presence and addressing all of us in this keynote address. And we would certainly be very happy and delighted if you could personally visit us post-COVID, and this learning can continue. We can learn more from your wisdom and experiences.
I will be there soon, wearing a mask and also carrying with me a certificate that I don't carry any positivity in terms of COVID. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
I will carry positive mind, but not positivity of corona. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you.
God bless you. Thank you.